Today we're going to be taking a very interesting look into the mind of a philosopher that I don't think gets enough credit in the modern day. Now, granted, there is a game of priorities that has to be played about which philosopher should be focused on, and obviously Baudelaire and Arthur Schopenhauer, among others, are not in the normal education of a philosopher. However, I think Arthur Schopenhauer stands at an interesting spot in history in terms of the contemporaries around him, as well as the thought that he's trying to express. And as such, I think that it is only fitting that a lecture series is done on this brilliant set of essays by Arthur Schopenhauer called Studies in Pessimism. This particular volume is what I'm going to be drawing from when I am going through these essays, and I will not be doing a lecture series on the essay on women because it's quite misogynistic. Even the editor has to put in the beginning, "The essay on women must not be taken in jest. It expresses Schopenhauer's sincere, serious convictions." And I don't find it useful to go over that essay, so we'll be skipping that one. This collection of texts has been very influential on me as a thinker, and as I've kind of gone through my philosophical journey, I've always found myself going back to what Schopenhauer says, because this essay, the first essay in this series of essays, is so useful. It's titled On the Sufferings of the World, and the title in and of itself may make one kind of fall back in terror at the sound of something so depressing. And I think this is one of the unfortunate or fortunate parts of Schopenhauer's philosophy, is it is extremely pessimistic. However, there is a key level of optimism in the text, insofar as Nietzsche is kind of the same way, even though he kind of wants to get us to understand that, like, man is a biological machine, you know, very Darwinian inspired. All the same, these essays do have a light twist, even though it's a very dark subject matter. And the first time I read Arthur Schopenhauer, I interpreted this essay very negatively, and it inspired a form of thought that would go on to occupy me for a while, which was very pessimistic. This got me into, for example, David Benatar's Better Never to Have Been, which is a very interesting book about antinatalism, which is the philosophical position that having children is immoral. But Schopenhauer, upon further reading, has proven to be very beneficial, and I think his thought extends well beyond just his isolated case, which is something we might like to think, considering that he doesn't receive a lot of attention. This essay in particular is all about asking life to justify itself. Man finds himself in a world almost inconspicuously, and it seems that we haven't asked for existence, but nevertheless we have to tarry with it, and we have to learn how to respond to it effectively. It's like being a character in a board game, and you have just been dropped onto the board without having asked to have been there. This problem has likely existed for a long time, likely as long as humans have been alive, and maybe beyond solely human life. However, it has received a lot of attention all throughout the history of thought, whether that be Ecclesiastes, which I will go into a little bit of detail later as a very important part of this same train of thought, but it's also been expressed, for example, in existentialism. Existentialism very much is asking us to question life's merits and how we should respond to life as such. And the sort of philosophical impetus for Schopenhauer's thought is very well expressed in the introductory paragraph to Maurice Blondel's Action, 1893, which was his doctoral dissertation. He says, "Yes or no, does human life make sense, and does man have a destiny? I act, but without even knowing what action is, without having wish to live, without knowing exactly either who I am or even if I am. This appearance of being which flutters about within me, these light and evanescent actions of a shadow bear in them, I am told, an eternally weighty responsibility, and that even at the price of blood, I cannot buy nothingness because for me it is no longer. Supposedly then, I am condemned to life, condemned to death, condemned to eternity. Why and by what right if I did not know it and did not will it? Blondel is experiencing a sort of disillusionment with reality, or rather a more philosophical and more critical perspective on life, which is the building block of all of our thought itself. And this is expressed much earlier in Ecclesiastes, which is a book from the Old Testament, which is very much a tarrying with life and how to make sense of life in the face of death, which is very much something that Schopenhauer is trying to get at. It says, vanity of vanities, says the teacher, vanity of vanities, all is vanity, which, of course, while very simple and almost seemingly tautological, says a lot. He goes on to say, I, the teacher, when king over Israel in Jerusalem, applied my mind to seek and to search out by wisdom all that is done under heaven. It is an unhappy business that God has given to human beings to be busy with. I saw all the deeds that are done under the sun, and see, all is vanity and a chasing after wind. What is crooked cannot be made straight, and what is lacking cannot be counted. Now, these may seem like very isolated instances of extreme pessimism, but Schopenhauer wants to dig a lot deeper into this. These people are all questioning life in the broader sense and coming into an interrogation with life. This essay by Arthur Schopenhauer on the sufferings of the world, which is the first in this series, asks us to critically examine life, but not only to do this, but if life is justifiable, what place should suffering have in life, and how should we make sense of this? Poignant, tearing, and gut-wrenching, Schopenhauer's philosophy is going to make us stare at our own existence and ask why. Schopenhauer starts off this essay in a very interesting manner, asking us to question the place of suffering, which seems fitting considering that this is about the sufferings of the world. He says that misfortune in general is the rule, and goes on to say, I know of no greater absurdity than that propounded by most systems of philosophy in declaring evil to be negative in its character. Evil is just what is positive. It makes its own existence felt. This is a very interesting idea because it is an interesting element of the discussion of antinatalism, like I briefly mentioned before, which is the idea that childbearing is immoral. And those who would uphold this kind of theory would say that suffering holds greater significance than pleasure. And Schopenhauer certainly seems to think so when he says, we generally find pleasure to be not nearly so pleasant as we expected, and pain very much more painful. Now, it's an interesting part of his thought because it's not exactly something provable. Maybe you could do it on some sort of logical grounds, but certainly that's not what Schopenhauer is doing here. This is much like Nietzsche's philosophy, which is very literary, and even though, for example, Nietzsche is kind of considered an analytic philosopher, kind of a continental, kind of in between. He doesn't go through that sort of rational proof making that we might get from analytic philosophy nowadays in kind of logical syllogisms. He goes on to say, the pleasure in this world, it has been said, outweighs the pain, or at any rate, there's an even balance between the two. If the reader wishes to see shortly whether this statement is true, let him compare the respective feelings of two animals, one of which is engaged in eating the other. Now, this is very strange because it's very reminiscent of Sam Harris, who did a tweet and he was trying to get objective moral values from nature. And he said that if human well-being is not objectively valuable, consult your stove by placing your hand on it or something like that. And in the same sense, you know, this isn't a very robust argument necessarily, but it is poignant, and it does ask us to question the place of suffering, not only because Schopenhauer asks us to consider suffering in the face of pleasure in terms of suffering seems to have more value because it is almost worse than our expectations, and pleasure doesn't seem to measure up to our expectations. But he asks us to envision these two animals, and we've got one being eaten by the other. And he's asking in which sense, which of these is having a stronger feeling. And he wants us to say that the one that is suffering is having stronger feelings rather than the one that is eating. And I think you could make this argument partially because suffering seems to be more unique. The position of this animal being eaten is a very unique kind of suffering, whereas the pleasure that might be gained from this animal that is eating might seem like it's a bit more commonplace. Like, you could get this sort of pleasure from doing anything. And of course, Schopenhauer wants us to start here by questioning the role of suffering, and he wants to make the case that suffering is not only integral to human life, but that it defines life. And he goes on to say this in a more explicit matter later. Schopenhauer does give us a small moment of pause, though. Often I am harkened back to Dostoevsky talking about suffering and talking about pleasure and a utopian society. And I can't remember in which text he does it, but I remember Jordan Peterson loves to quote this, and I feel bad that I can even remember that it was Jordan Peterson, because I'm not particularly a fan of his. But Dostoevsky asks us to imagine that we have all of our desires fulfilled, and Dostoevsky says that nevertheless we would have some form of human retribution in which we do some heinous act just to remain human or continue to feel human. And I even put in my notes in this book, because I have very detailed note-taking, that this predates the Dostoevskian view on utopia, because of course when one sees Dostoevsky make that insight, you just assume, oh, he came up with that. But no, Schopenhauer states, certain it is that work, worry, labor, and trouble form the lot of almost all men their whole life long. But if all wishes were fulfilled as soon as they arose, how would men occupy their lives? What would they do with their time? If the world were a paradise of luxury and ease, a land flowing with milk and honey where every Jack obtained his Jill at once and without any difficulty, men would either die of boredom or hang themselves. Or there would be wars, massacres, and murders, so that in the end, mankind would inflict more suffering on itself than it has now to accept at the hands of nature. So this is a very interesting idea because, and he kind of goes on to criticize this later, but the idea that we're in the best possible world, that if there was less suffering than there was now, and people were in a better state, they would end up just kind of coming back to themselves and destroying themselves in warlike tendencies or something like this. So it does give us pause to not come too far against the idea of suffering, because he does want to imply that there's some utility and some instrumentality inside of suffering. But the problem nevertheless remains why it is here, and he wants to examine this critically. Now, an interesting thing that Schopenhauer wants to bring our attention to is alternate forms of existence. His philosophy very much has a concernful eye towards human existence and asks what it might be like to be other ways, or ways in which the adult mode of being is a deficient mode of being. And he mentions how the blindness, in a sense, of childhood might be favorable. He says, "In early youth, as we contemplate our coming life, we are like children in a theater before the curtain is raised, sitting there in high spirits and eagerly waiting for the play to begin. It is a blessing that we do not know what is really going to happen. Could we foresee it, there are times when children might seem like innocent prisoners, condemned not to death, but to life, and as yet all unconscious of what their sentence means. Nevertheless, every man desires to reach old age, in other words, a state of life of which it may be said, it is bad today, and it will be worse tomorrow, and so on till the worst of all." And this is a really strange idea that leads him to some properly antinatalist ideas. He says, "If children were brought into the world by an act of pure reason alone, would the human race continue to exist? Would not a man rather have so much sympathy with the coming generation as to spare it the burden of existence?" And this is actually something that is mentioned in Ecclesiastes. In Ecclesiastes, in chapter 4, verse 2, it says, "And I thought the dead who have already died more fortunate than the living who are still alive, but better than both is the one who has not yet been, and has not seen the evil deeds that are done under the sun." And Schopenhauer is very keen to this idea that just because we find ourselves in a state of living, that doesn't necessarily entail that this is the best possible scenario. We can imagine these alternative scenarios in which we might not have been. And Schopenhauer, by opening our eyes to the idea of suffering, is making us question, first off, why it's there in the first place, and also what a life would be like without suffering, and if this is something that could be achieved, or if we could even talk about ourselves being fortunate not to have been. He says, "Every state of welfare, every feeling of satisfaction is negative in its character. That is to say, it consists in freedom from pain, which is the positive element of existence. It follows, therefore, that the happiness of any given life is to be measured not by its joys and pleasures, but by the extent to which it has been free from suffering, from positive evil." And I have in my notes that this is kind of a pseudo-utilitarian idea. Considering that Schopenhauer thinks suffering to be the negative aspect of life, he sees that the value in life comes, first off, it doesn't seem by the way that he phrases it that value is necessarily inherent to anything, but rather that value is determined based off the extent to which suffering is avoided. So there's a sort of privation theory of pleasure and pain, that pleasure is the privation of suffering, which is the default state of everything. And as such, pleasure values a lot more, or is valued a lot more, not only just because it's pleasureful and it feels good, but because it's the exception, it's the minority. And this, I'll highlight this later, is kind of a pitfall of the philosophy. Is this asymmetry might be unjustified. Thank you. When it comes to thinking of alternate ideas of existence, for example, one might be driving in a car on a road trip and look at cows grazing and be, oh, how great would it be to be a cow and just graze and not worry about all that. Some people approach that idea and think very negatively. They think, well, there's some unique greatness about being a human that can't be found in being another animal. Being a cow, yes, you just eat, but that's all you do. You don't tarry with the world socially, and you don't really feel things or have rational decision-making capabilities. And probably most importantly, you aren't conscious of your life. Now, the way this is usually thought, people usually concede there that, oh yes, it is so much better to be conscious of our lives rather than being forced to kind of be a machine. And when we talk about free will, those who are using free will to butt up against determinism would say, well, determinism sucks. We'd just be a robot. We wouldn't have any control and we wouldn't have any agency. And of course, this agency is deemed as very powerful. And Schopenhauer here wants to kind of go against this idea of human exceptionalism towards a sort of ethical universalism where all entities are worthy insofar as the human exceptions make us even more prone to suffering. And as such, it doesn't seem that maybe our condition is necessarily the best. He says, as far as real physical pleasure is concerned, the man is not better off than the brute, except insofar as the higher possibilities of his nervous system make him more sensitive to every kind of pleasure, but also, it must be remembered, to every kind of pain. This is interesting because it raises the idea that maybe consciousness is not such a good thing because we are not only more attuned to the pleasurable things in life because we can reflect on them and enjoy them, but also the suffering is magnified and made greater. Now, of course, to the extent that this is accentuated is unclear. I'm not sure empirically how we would go about testing this. I would presume this would be a neuroscience thing, which I'm not particularly adept in. But Schopenhauer extends the problem a little further when he talks about our powers of reflection, as he calls it. After talking about the way the human is able to reflect on their pleasures and make them greater, he says, but the brute has nothing of the kind. Whenever it is in pain, it is as though it were suffering for the first time, even though the same thing should have previously happened to it times out of number. It has no power of summing up its feelings, hence its careless and placid temper. How much it is to be envied. And of course, the idea here is, as occurs to the person looking out their window at the cows, there's something careless and placid, as Schopenhauer says, or there's something serene about just being able to tarry with the world in a way where you're not worrying about the world, you're just existing. And this idea that animals don't have reflection, or I should say other animals having reflection, because reflection requires being conscious and being conscious of this reflection that's happening instead of just being instinctual, that this lack of an experience might actually be good because it means that this magnification of suffering happens less. And if Schopenhauer is right that suffering is more significant than pleasure, not only because it's more abundant, but if suffering is worth more than pleasure, then reducing that magnification would actually be better because we would be reducing a lot more suffering than we would pleasure. A way that this occurred to me is when thinking about the way expecting pleasure or pain will accentuate it. This occurred to me in a little bit of a funny story. It was prom day, and it was about 11 in the morning, and I had some Chipotle in my car. had been left in my car overnight, and I had eaten it, not thinking that it has steak inside it and that it's going to go bad and it's going to get all kinds of bacteria and potentially give me food poisoning. And of course, it wasn't until after my mother inquired into my situation that I was like, oh, I shouldn't have eaten that. For the rest of the day, I was so worried about getting food poisoning that I started to reflect on my inner situation, and anytime my stomach would move, I would think that this was a symptom of food poisoning, that this was indicative of just what I had thought. And of course, I started to feel cold and shaky, and I went the whole day never having food poisoning, and I was completely fine. But the point is that the anticipation of this suffering may have increased my suffering. The pure mental anguish, especially for people who, like me, who care a lot about how the body works, it's easy to be cognizant of what could happen if, for example, I got food poisoning. And as such, that completely heightens the sense of confusion and despair that happens. And Schopenhauer, I think, is aware of this, which is that oftentimes we psych ourselves out. And this is something that the brute, or just other animals, or lower animals, I guess you could say, cognitively speaking, don't have this problem of psyching themselves out, because they don't quite have this level of consciousness. Now, in a way similar to how we had just been talking, Schopenhauer keys us into the idea that suffering is not merely physical. He says, "There is a separate and peculiar source of pleasure, and consequently of pain, which man has established for himself, also as the result of using his powers of reflection. And this occupies him out of all proportion to its value, nay, almost more than all his other interests put together. I mean ambition and the feeling of honor and shame. In plain words, what he thinks about the opinions of other people, about the opinion other people have on him. Taking 1,000 forms, often very strange ones, this becomes the goal of almost all the efforts he makes that are not rooted in physical pleasure or pain." And this is a very interesting idea. How do our abilities to tarry with the world socially accentuate our feelings of suffering? Heidegger was very interested in this, and in Being and Time, he speaks of Das Man, which I did a whole video in my Heidegger Concept series about Das Man, if you want to go back and learn about that. It's very interesting. But Das Man translates to the they, and Das Man is not merely the kind of weasel words we hear in political discourse. For example, when someone makes some sort of conspiracy theory, they might say, they are against us and they're trying to suppress our freedom. Well, who is they? It often happens that you can tell you're in weaselly territory when they is used so ambiguously. And of course, this is what we call weasel words. The they, for Heidegger, or Das Man, is not an ambiguous they in the sense that it's some people we're just not talking about. It's the idea of others in general. It's the idea that there is an other that we have to be accountable to. And Heidegger paints Das Man in a very negative way. He states that in our everyday being, our situation in which we consider how others will interpret our actions is actually a deficient mode of being. He says, "In this inconspicuousness and unascertainability, the real dictatorship of the they is unfolded. We take pleasure and enjoy ourselves as they, man, take pleasure. We read, see, and judge about literature and art as they see and judge. Likewise, we shrink back from the great mass as they shrink back. We find shocking what they find shocking. The they, which is nothing definite, and which all are, though not as the sum, prescribes the kind of being of everydayness." Now, of course, this is steeped in the confusing Heideggerian language, But the dictatorship of the they, I think, is exactly what Schopenhauer is getting at in a sense, which is that there is a unique form of suffering that occurs when we consider the way we are being viewed. For example, you might be wearing an outfit that is tolerable to your conscience. It presents no feelings of unrest when you wear it. You feel really good in it, but then you go outside and maybe it's a button up and you've buttoned down one more button than normal, or maybe the sleeves are too short and it makes you subconscious about your arms, or maybe your shorts are too short and you get unconscious or you get nervous about the way your legs might be viewed. This is the tarrying with Das Man that Heidegger speaks of. And the key part about understanding what Das Man is, and by extension exactly what Schopenhauer is trying to talk about, is that no one has to come up and tell us that they think our outfit looks weird on us. And when we have these sorts of second thoughts, it's not because we even know that someone is saying this. Oftentimes we're fully cognizant of the fact that this is merely us creating this negative image of ourselves. But importantly, this negative image comes from doubting ourselves because we consider the possibility of what other people are thinking about us. And this is the suffering that Schopenhauer is talking about, which is the kind of suffering that not only is ambiguous, but doesn't even have to actually have been given to us. No one has to actually tell us that our outfit looks bad for us to subconsciously, you know, go back into the house and change or something like that. And this is a very hard-hitting point, not only because it precedes a lot of more complex thought like Heidegger's on the same issue, but in general, it shares that existentialist way of really meeting us in our daily lives and explaining a very unique form of suffering that might not have occurred to us otherwise. Not only is there that usual form of suffering that might occur from Das Man, from the they, from that other ambiguous other that, as Heidegger says, all of us are, in a sense, because we are all an other, in a sense, even to ourselves. Schopenhauer talks about the idea that merely our usual state of existence can present a situation of suffering to us. He says boredom is a form of suffering unknown to brutes. And this is interesting because, in a sense, you can imagine when he speaks of brutes, he's speaking of animals that act purely on biologically instantiated instinct. And as a result of being conscious of what's going on, humans often become bored. And this is a unique form of suffering in its own. We desire to be free from desire. We desire to be free of things that we have to attend to. But then, of course, when this is stripped away, we are attenuated to a unique form of suffering, that being boredom, or precisely the absence of apparent suffering is a form of suffering, which very much has the existentialist sort of churning back against one's own condition and realizing that things are actually a bit more complicated than it might have at first seemed. Now, a small point of contention that I mentioned earlier is that Schopenhauer asserts an asymmetry between suffering and pleasure. He says that certainly most, he might not necessarily say all, but most situations in which there is suffering and pleasure, the suffering outweighs the pleasure. For example, he says, as regards the sexual relation, man is committed to a particular arrangement, to a peculiar arrangement, which drives him obstinately to choose one person. This feeling grows now and then into a more or less passionate love, which is the source of little pleasure and much suffering. And in my notes, I wrote, why? Why is it that it seems purely based off of his personal experiences of maybe bad experiences with love, sexual or romantic, that he deduces that it's the source of little pleasure and much suffering? It certainly doesn't seem a rule that suffering is greater than pleasure quantitatively. Qualitatively, that's a different idea. But in terms of quantity, for example, I find myself in a perfectly pleasurable relationship, free from virtually any suffering of any kind. In fact, it sort of leeches on the rest of my life and takes out the suffering from the rest of my life. So certainly, I think this is where we get a hint into the idea that Schopenhauer's philosophy is not purely analytic and purely logically necessitated. It's sometimes just inserting pathos into the argumentation, which can be effective and I think brings us to some interesting ideas. But it's important to note that this is a legitimate sense where Heidegger's philosophy becomes not quite philosophy sometimes, and more so prose or beautiful rhetoric. Now, going back to the idea of living life as a brute, he goes through this essay, as we've kind of been going through this essay systematically, kind of going back and touching on points as they occur later or earlier, but he goes back to talking about advantages of life as a brute, as he would call it. He says, and yet, when all is told, he has been struggling ultimately for the very same things as the brute has attained, and with an incomparably smaller expenditure of passion and pain. So he implies that there's not so much of an expenditure that has to occur when engaging in a pleasureful experience as a brute. I think what he means here is that the brute, or I will say other animals, because that makes me feel better than saying brute, because sometimes that language is used for negative reasons in his philosophy, such as his essay on women. But besides the point, he seems to imply that non-human animals simply find themselves in pleasurable or painful experiences, and that there's not much of an expenditure that has to occur to engage in a pleasurable experience. Whereas if we compare that with human life and all the particular forms of suffering, like the kind of social suffering that can occur, there is a small amount of suffering that must be endured, it seems, for any pleasurable instance, because there is always that reflection going on, thinking, well, maybe this isn't going to be as pleasurable as I think, or I don't know if this pleasure is even actually going to happen to me. So he seems to imply here that there's some sort of sense in which the non-human animal doesn't have to worry so much about whether or not they're going to be suffering or experiencing pleasure. They simply just find themselves in that situation, whereas humans have to kind of chew on it a little bit more. And he goes on to say, the pains of life are made much worse for man by the fact that death is something very real to him. The brute flies from death instinctively, without really knowing what it is, and therefore without ever contemplating it in the way natural to a man who has the prospect always before his eyes. And this kind of comes back to a similar sense in which the fact that we are cognitively aware of our situation means that even pleasure is diminished by the fact that death is always present to us. And I think, for example, if you read Ecclesiastes, the author very much, you know, vanity of vanities. He's talking about the fact that everything is seemingly hopeless in the face of death. and even pleasures of knowledge seem to diminish when we realize that it must come to an end at some point. And this, I think, is a very important idea of Schopenhauer's, which is the burden of consciousness itself, and how consciousness may be a form of suffering in and of itself. And going back to the idea of living as a brute, Schopenhauer says, there is one respect in which brutes show real wisdom when compared with us. I mean their quiet, placid enjoyment of the present moment. The tranquility of mind which this seems to give them often puts us to shame for the many times we allow our thoughts and our cares to make us restless and discontented. He goes on to say, the more we look forward to anything, the less satisfaction we find in it when it comes. But the brute's enjoyment is not anticipated and therefore suffers no deduction, so that the actual pleasure of the moment comes to it whole and unimpaired. He says in a very interesting kind of footnote at the end of a paragraph, and when I see how man misuses the dog, his best friend, how he ties up this intelligent animal with a chain, I feel the deepest sympathy with the brute and burning indignation against the master. So throughout this whole thing, again, he's continuing to talk about life as a brute and the ways in which this tranquil lifestyle, where we're not worried about anticipation, might actually be a great thing. Because I often find myself when I'm, you know, for example, thinking what it would be like to live as a cow. You know, I think, oh, I have no cares in the world. I just have to indulge in my desires. And some might say, well, this is a terrible existence. It's selfish and it provides us nothing. But I think in a sense, the suffering caused by anticipation, by being conscious, like we've talked about before, causes satisfaction to be diminished when it comes. Although I must be honest, he says that the more we look forward to something, the less exciting it is when it comes. I think that's less so the case, but rather that after the thing happens, the more we've looked forward to it, the more we realize that just looking forward to something is a form of pleasure, and that when that has been stripped away, we no longer have anything to look forward to. I think this is kind of the uniqueness of online shopping, is waiting for a package to come and having that anticipation and looking forward to something. And maybe Schopenhauer makes a good point here when he says that, you know, when that package comes, that pleasure is gone, or at least it's not as exciting as we thought the longer it takes for the package to get there. I wouldn't necessarily call this a rule, but he does make this an interesting point of contention. And to kind of go back to the ecclesiastical way of talking about things, he says, why and for what purpose does all this torment and agony exist? And as such, we find ourselves in an existence where it seems like there are ways in which being a different way would be better. And this takes us into the question of, well, where does God fit into this? If we're going to talk about suffering, we have to talk about God. Now, Schopenhauer is interesting because he's one of the first Western philosophers to use Buddhist ideas, or just Eastern ideas in general, and make us realize that they might be philosophically tenable, or at least interesting. He's talking about the Brahma is said to have produced the world by a kind of fall or mistake. In order to atone for his folly, he is bound to remain in it himself until he works out his redemption. And this is kind of an interesting idea that God is at war with himself. He goes on to use this as a kind of critique. He says, again, Ormuzd and Ahriman are rival powers, continually at war. That is not bad. But that a god like Jehovah should have created this world of misery and woe out of pure caprice, and because he enjoyed doing it, and should then have clapped his hands in praise of his own work and declared everything to be very good, that will not do at all. So he's saying that in a sense, the Buddhist idea makes sense because suffering has an excuse. Suffering is a mistake. And of course, in the Christian conception or in the Jewish conception, suffering is a mistake by man. But of course, then the question comes, to what extent is God responsible for what is going on here, considering that he's mightier than all this? And this is where Schopenhauer goes on, because, for example, Leibniz makes an interesting idea that the current world we're in is the best of all possible worlds, because if God is as great as he is said to be, he would create the most ideal world. And if we presume that God exists, which of course is a big presumption, it therefore seems that we are by logical necessity in the best of all possible worlds. Now, Schopenhauer has a contention here. He says, even though Leibniz's contention that this is the best of all possible worlds were correct, that would not justify God in having created it. For he is the creator not of the world only, but of possibility itself. And therefore, he ought to have so ordered possibility as that it would admit of something better. And this is very much something that the author of Ecclesiastes is suffering with, which is that bad and good people are meeting the same end, Sheol, the grave. Animals and humans are meeting the same fate. And the question, of course, is, why this same fate? Why this suffering? And Schopenhauer makes an interesting contention, which is that even if this is the best of all possible worlds, Schopenhauer says that possibility, or kind of what the world could be, is up to God if God is as powerful as he's claimed to be. And this is an interesting idea, which I think a lot of modern theologians are trying to figure out, which is, what is the extent of God's greatness or all-powerfulness? For example, can he make a stone so heavy that he can't lift it, as a common example? And what it's trying to ask is God able to do things logically impossible? Because if he is able to do things that are logically impossible, then he has made something he can't do in this situation. But of course, if he can't do something logically impossible, then there's something he can't do. And it seems that either way, there's something that can't be done. And a lot of theologians have said, well, God can't go against the laws of logic, which, personal contentions aside, Schopenhauer is kind of using the sort of reasoning which is saying that even if this is the best of all possibilities, why is it that possibilities are such? Why is it that this is the best of all possible situations? And of course, many thinkers have thought, is this the best that God can do? Now, this is where things get a little bit interesting, because Schopenhauer himself is an atheist, and despite this, he seems to be fairly well-read in what is going on in the religious contexts, and wants to create what he goes on to later call the only true Christian philosophy. He says, the New Testament declares law to have failed, frees man from its dominion, and in its stead preaches the kingdom of grace to be won by faith, love of neighbor, and entire sacrifice of self. He says, asceticism is the denial of the will to live. Redemption through the mediator, from the domain of sin and death to eternal life in Christ, means, when taken in its real sense, the transition from the merely moral virtues to the denial of the will to live. This is a really interesting idea, because in a sense, we are going beyond the will to live, beyond that thing that tells us that our life inherently has value, and rather we are becoming ascetics. We are denying that will to live its power over us, because I think one of the contentions that a lot of people might have with living life as a brute or as a non-human animal is that you are a slave to your desires. This is the problem people will have with determinism as opposed to free will, is that you're just a pure slave to your desires and you have no agency. And in a sense, here we are becoming ascetics and we are going against that will to live. We are sacrificing ourselves completely and we are becoming beyond good and evil, I think, as Nietzsche would say. We are transitioning from the merely moral virtues to the denial of the will to live. And he presents this as something really wonderful. He says that my doctrine might be called the only true Christian philosophy. He goes on to say, you cannot do better than accustom yourself to regard this world as a penitentiary, a sort of penal colony. And this might sound like a terrible existence that we have been put into, to tarry with living life essentially as a prisoner, because he talks about, earlier as we talked about, life being a cheat. And it seems like we're in a very bad situation, but there's a fantastic turn of events that is about to happen, in which the denial of the will to live leads to compassion among each other and a unique form of pleasure that might be had from venturing beyond the desires and going beyond simply morality and beyond the slave of that desire to live and seeing ourselves as fellow members of a deteriorating form of life, which the person in Ecclesiastes kind of highlights when they talk about humans and animals having the same fate. In a very stunning ending to, of course, a very pessimistic essay, he wants to bring this all back and speak more on this denial of the will to live, because the will is a very important part of Schopenhauer's philosophy, that we are a slave to our will and that our will controls how we experience life. He says, pardons the word to all. Whatever folly men commit, be their shortcomings or their vices what they may, let us exercise forbearance, remembering that when these faults appear in others, it is our follies and vices that we behold. They are the shortcomings of humanity to which we belong, which is a very kind of Darwinian way of thinking about everything as a unity, whose faults, one and all, we share. Yes, even those very faults at which we now wax so indignant, merely because they have not yet appeared in ourselves. They are faults that do not lie on the surface, but they exist down there in the depths of our nature, and should anything call them forth, they will come and show themselves just as we now see them in others. And in a sense, this is the idea of grace, of forbearance, as he calls it, of realizing that just because those mistakes haven't appeared in us, doesn't mean that we have any less of a proclivity towards them, which seems to present a unique situation in which we become a mirror into each other, and as a result, we go beyond morality, beyond merely pointing the finger and saying, no, you are immoral and you are evil, and rather accepting the face of death and how that should make us congeal our own faces. And he finishes this off so nicely by saying, in fact, the conviction that the world and man is something that had better not have been is of a kind to fill us with indulgence towards one another. Nay, from this point of view, we might well consider the proper form of address to be not Monsieur, Sir, mein Herr, but my fellow sufferer, socii malorum, compagnon de miseres, which is such an interesting way of putting it, that we are all sufferers. And the author of Ecclesiastes says a very similar thing when talking about the fact that everyone is going to shale ultimately. And I think this is the very unique turn that, especially for me as a reader reading it the first time, I didn't really understand the point, which is not to have some sort of moral aversion to life itself and become suicidal, which is definitely how it appeared to me on first glance, but rather it's to go beyond merely the law, as he talked about Christianity going against, that no longer does the law simply work, but we must go beyond this and simply have grace towards one another and have forbearance for each other's situations as being fellow sufferers in this world. So I hope this has been really useful and enlightening, and I hope that it may consider you to get your hands on this set of essays in the hopes that it might unlock some sort of unique connection with the world and a longing that might not have been previously understood with the place of suffering, and how reflecting on this suffering and reflecting on the seemingly dire situation of the universe might actually put us in a very unique position to experience pleasure in that situation and realize that maybe it is good to have been.